God is going to do some things in our lives. If you think about the messages that we've been hearing lately, it's been about, you know, trusting God for more, believing God to do something spectacular, having the faith to release God to do it. You almost hate to use the word release because it can imply that somehow God is bound. But the reality is God is bound to his word. So when he sets forth and establishes a way of bringing something about, and we're involved in that process, there's something that we need to do, then release would be the right word. Not because he's not able, but because he's not a man that he should lie. Neither is he the Son of Man that he should repent. And so I want to challenge us this afternoon that we do our part to release God to do what he already wants to do, what he already wants to do in our lives. So let's turn to Genesis. That would be the first book of the Bible. Chapter 13. Genesis 13. Generally I read from the New American Standard, and I will be reading from the New American Standard today as well. However, there will be a couple of passages that I really enjoy how the King James put it. So a couple of passages, we'll flip over to the King James. But for now, in the New American Standard here, beginning at verse 1 in Genesis 13, and you find this. So Abram went up from Egypt to the Negev, he and his wife, and all that belonged to him. Somebody say, and Lot with him. We're going to find out about that. There's some unfortunate power in that phrase. Every ounce of power and potential isn't necessarily good. But that phrase right there had a lot to do with challenges that Abraham faced, and Lot with him. But it says, now Abram was very rich in livestock, in silver, and in gold. And he went on his journeys from the Negev as far as Bethel to the place where his tent had been at the beginning, between Bethel and Ai, to the place of the altar which he had made there formerly. And there Abram called on the name of the Lord, much as we did this morning. Now Lot, who went with Abram, now notice the scripture is trying to reinforce the fact that Lot was a tag-along. Lot didn't have his own mission. He went with Abram. See, if you really want God to prosper and bless your life, you need to get your own mission. It doesn't mean you can't help somebody else, but you have to have your own purpose. You have to get a word from God for your life, because watch this, your life matters beyond just the fact that you're connected to somebody else. Did you hear that?
Yes.
You cannot find value and worth in your life based on who you're connected with. But Lot tug along. So he says here, now Lot, who went with Abram, verse 5, also had flocks and herds and tents. I want you to keep that in mind. Lot also had flocks and herds and tents. And the land could not sustain them while dwelling together, for their possessions, were so great that they were not able to remain together. And there was strife between the herdsmen of Abram's livestock and the herdsmen of Lot's livestock. So Lot had flocks and herds and tents and herdsmen, right? Just like Abram. And so there arose this strife between them. Now the Canaanite and the Perizzite were dwelling then in the land. Then Abram said to Lot, please, let there be no strife between you and me, nor between my herdsmen and your herdsmen, for we are brothers. Is not the whole land, now when he says brothers, he means we're kin. They weren't actually brothers, he was Lot's uncle, but they were kinfolk. Is not the whole land before you? Please separate from me, if to the left, then I will go to the right, or if to the right, then I will go to the left. And Lot lifted up his eyes, and Lot, the Tagalog, lifted up his eyes and saw the valley of the Jordan, that it was well watered everywhere. Now, this was before the Lord destroyed Sodom and Gomorrah. He saw that it was like the garden of the Lord, like the land of Egypt as you go to Zoar. So Lot said, well, uncle, I have benefited from your blessings so long. I'm going to give you the land that looks nice and lush and green. No. What does the leech do? It says, so Lot chose for himself all the valley of the Jordan, and Lot journeyed eastward. Thus they separated from each other. Abram settled in the land of Canaan, while Lot settled in the cities of the valley and moved his tents as far as Sodom. Now, the men of Sodom were wicked exceedingly and sinners against the Lord. We've studied that enough to know exactly how they were wicked. It was not how tradition says they were. And the Lord said to Abram after, somebody say after. See, sometimes the people who are tagging along are preventing God. Oh, y'all coming with me today? Sometimes, because you care about them, you love them, but sometimes they are blocking what God is trying to do in your life. So the Lord said to Abram, after Lot had separated from him, now lift up your eyes and look from the place where you are, northward and southward and eastward and westward. For all the land which you see, I will give to you and to your descendants forever. Forever. So we come here and we see that Lot chose for himself the plot of land that looked easy. Where if I'm going to separate myself from my benefactor, I want to have easy goings. So he looks, it said he looked up. What does it say right here? In verse 10, Lot lifted up his eyes and he looked, watch this, with his physical eyes. And he saw a place that looked good. But how many of y'all know everything that looks good to you is not good for you? Because the next time we see Lot, it's in the next chapter, in chapter 14. And Lot is living. He's no longer just in the land like he was. He's now living just one chapter later in Sodom. And we have no notice whatsoever of any possessions, of any herdsmen, of any flocks, of anything. In fact, Lot is taken captive. And good old Uncle Abraham has to come free him. So he said, well, Lot, what happened? Everything, I let you choose whatever you wanted to choose. I did everything I possibly could to allow you to prosper. What are you doing mixing with these heathens? With these cruel, evil folk. He said, because I no longer had anybody to take care of me. So I went to Sodom because Sodom was a wealthy place. And I don't know how to do it on my own. Everything I had, I lost. You find out, so he's over in Sodom, doesn't have anything. He gets captured. Abraham releases him, goes and fights the tribe and releases him. And returns them. He's still in Sodom. We get around to, I think it's chapter 18 or chapter 19, and the story when God destroyed Sodom. And it was only because of Lot's connection with Abraham that God chose to spare Lot's life. And so he sends the angels in there, right, to tell Lot to get out, right? What does Lot leave with? His herdsmen, his cattle, his flock. No, he didn't have them. What did he leave with? His wife, his daughters. That's it. That's it. The man who was probably not as rich, but at least almost as wealthy as Abram. He had enough herdsmen where there could actually be strife between the two camps. It wasn't like 100 to 2. And yet, here he has nothing. Why does he have nothing? Because he allowed himself to be deceived by what he saw. He made a decision based on what he saw. Why would Abram at this time tell Lot, choose whichever path you want to choose, and wherever you go, I'll go the other way. Because Abram had enough faith to know, I'm blessed. So even if I go into the desert, grass will start to grow. Even if I go to a dry place, water will begin flowing, because the blessing of the Lord is upon my life. So Lot, I'm going to let you choose wherever you want to go. And after Lot left, God was able to do in Abram's life what he wanted to do the moment he told Abram, get up from your family and leave. Isn't that what God told Abram? He told him to get away from your father's house and go to a far-off land that I will show you. He gets get far away, because sometimes those closest to us are the very ones holding us back, because they can't see anything but the person they raised. They can't see anything but that little cousin. They don't see the potential that God has within us. And so sometimes God has to remove us from that environment, because the prophet is not received in his own house. So he has to get us out. But what does Abram do? Abram loves. He loves his crazy brother son. And even though God told him, get thee up and get thee out, he couldn't. But that Lot just can't do well on his own. And his daddy done already kicked him out. Because daddy had enough. And daddy said, you got to go. Now, I don't know where you're going to go, but you got to leave here. Because you are too old to still be acting the way you're acting. So here's your inheritance, like the prodigal son. Here's your inheritance. Here are your cattle. Here are your flocks. Now go live your life. And Abram said, now, if I don't keep this man under my wing, he'll be broke in a month. So Lot, come on with me. And so when he brought Lot out, he put the purpose of God on pause. Why? Because God told him, get away. Get free. Because I don't want the vampires in your life sucking the life out of the blessing that I am about to give you. So when you think about it that way, thank God there arose a strife. Something had to arise that was strong enough and strenuous enough and tumultuous enough to make Abram finally let go. Because he just wouldn't do it. So I would go as far as to say that it was probably God that caused this strife to even arise, so that something could happen that would finally make Abram get enough. And finally Abram said, look, you go your way and I'll go mine. So he says here, the land, verse 15, the land which you see, I will give it to you and to your descendants forever. Now understand that although he is talking about physical sight here, I want you to see that he's really talking to us in relation to spiritual sight. Because we're going to make this contrast between the plush and lushness that Lot saw with the physical eye, and what Abram was able to see as his inheritance, or what God shows us in our lives that belongs to us. But we have to look with our spiritual eyes, because our natural eyes will not necessarily give us an accurate and adequate representation of what lies ahead. See, you took that job because it paid more, but the company folded 6 months later. so your eyes deceive you. You bought the house because it was bigger. I got all this square footage, and the price per square foot was really low. So I bought this big house, had this big lot, and I had all this property because it was so cheap. Got in there, and it was full of rats. There was a reason it was so cheap. Got in there, and every 2 weeks the house was broken into. There was a reason it was so cheap. And so we have to learn how to stop letting our eyes deceive us and trust that whatever God is showing us is where we need to go. And that takes faith. Why? Because from the moment that we are born, we are trained to interact with the world through our senses. That's why they call them senses. It's the means by which we sense that which is around us. It's the means by which we understand that there is a physical world. I know that's physical because I can feel it. I know it's, I can smell it. I can see it. Right? So we have these senses that teach us about the world around us. The moment that we're born, we're trained to hone them and to develop them. If you were even to look at it, you know how they say from the evolutionary stance, well, thousands and hundreds of thousands of years ago, we were the hunter-gatherers, and it was necessary for us to have good hearing and good sight in order to survive the attacks of predators. So we've learned to depend on these senses. And so from the moment that we get born again, we begin this, I hate to call it unfortunate, we begin this difficult process of trying to reprogram ourselves. Man, I want to tell you this. Just like you have physical senses, you also have spiritual senses. You have spiritual sight. You have spiritual hearing. And we have to learn how to tap in and how to hone it. You weren't able to just make sense of everything you saw and everything you heard when you were a baby. You needed time to actually get to know and learn your senses and what they meant. And in the same way, we have, in many cases, failed to develop ourselves spiritually enough to be able to hone these spiritual senses and know what the heck is happening in a world we can't see with our spirit, with our physical eyes, but which still changes our lives. And so the question is, God, help us to develop enough so that we do not become Lot, so that we do not become moved out of place by what we see. The world even knows it. What do they say? Well, the grass always looks greener, but you can't always go by what you see. So even the world has learned these principles, and yet we're still kind of getting stuck with what we see. Let's turn to Mark 11. The Gospel of Mark, chapter 11. Mark 11. What does God say to Abram? He says, as far as your eyes see, not as far as you say you want, as far as your eyes see, I will give you. What is the moral of that story? You got to see it to receive it. You have to see it to receive it. But contrary to Lot, you have to see it with the right eyes. And that's actually my subject this afternoon. Seeing, now, not the world's way. Seeing is believing. But the Bible way, seeing is receiving. Seeing is receiving. So he says here in Mark 11, verse 24. Think about this real quick. Take a quick moment. Close your eyes. I want you to visualize something. Visualize Abram sitting atop this hill, this cliff, and seeing all this land out before him. Clear day. Mountains of He inhales a mountain way off in the distance. You see all this, and God says, everything you see, turn around, 360 degrees, everything you see, I will give to you. What does that mean? That means that the scope of your potential is limited by the range of your vision. Because if you can see it, he said, I'll get it. So the only thing you're limited by is how far you can see. Now, if you ever want a 2020 vision, now's the time to get it. Now I'm talking about in the spirit. Because as far as you can see, he'll give it. Mark 11, verse 24. He says this. Therefore, I say to you, Jesus talking. In fact, put the King James up if you will. Therefore, I say unto you, what things soever ye desire, when ye pray, believe that ye receive them, and ye shall have them. Whatsoever things ye desire, when ye pray, believe that ye have received them. Now notice something here. He says, believe that you receive them, and you shall have them. He did not say, whatsoever things ye desire when ye pray, ye shall have them. There's a qualifier there. You have to believe that God is going to give it to you. No. No. Because if you are believing that he is going to give it to you, that means you don't have to. And he did not say, believe that ye shall receive it. Believe that in present tense, when you pray, believe that you receive it. And ye shall have it. See, receiving comes first. You have to receive it before you receive it. Does that make sense? You have to receive it spiritually at the moment you pray, when you ask, when you seek God for it. You have to see, watch this, you have to see with your spiritual eyes that it's yours. When you pray, you have to see in present tense, as Jesus said, when, not after, not later, not eventually, not in God's time, when you pray. Believe that ye receive them, and ye, as a result of that, shall have them. Now, unfortunately, a lot of us believers are already disqualified from this passage. Why? Because really two reasons. One, religion has taught us that it's not right to have a personal desire. That somehow we're not walking in humility if we actually want something better. Right? So religion has taught us to temper our dreams, to temper our hopes, and to not even want it. Ambition is evil. It's never right to want to move forward. But apparently, it's okay to have a desire. Because when we pray, to not only have the desire, but to actually ask God for it. Well, think about that. It's okay to ask God for a desire and not feel as though I'm being selfish or feel as though I'm being superficial. God careth for us. And all throughout the scripture, he makes promises about what things soever we desire. We know the passage, delight yourself also in the Lord, and he will give you the desires of your heart. No good thing will he withhold from them that walk uprightly before him. The blessing of the Lord maketh rich, and he added no sorrow with it. So God is saying it's okay to desire something. So the first thing we have to do is divorce ourselves from the spirit of religion that tells us we shouldn't want it. The second thing we have to do is divorce ourselves from life. Now, what do I mean by that? Life has a way of teaching you to stop wanting. Let me ask a question. How many people have ever desired after something and it did not materialize? Right? Did that feel good? It hurts to have these unfulfilled desires, to have a passion burning down in your soul. And year after year, it's not happening. And you're saying, God, when is this thing going to come to pass? I feel it. I want it. I desire it. It's this fire. Like the prophet says, like fire shut up in my bones. But it's not happening, God. Saints, that does not feel good. I don't care how many tongues you speak in or interpret. I don't care how much you prophesy. It does not feel good to have unfulfilled hopes and unfulfilled dreams. So life has a way of teaching us we'll stop hoping and stop dreaming. But we limit what God is able to do because whatever things we don't let ourselves desire, we're not releasing him. That's the word release again. We're not releasing him to do. But what about if I've already been desiring it for a long time and it never happened? Did you receive it when you prayed? See, we can't tell God when to make manifest in the natural, but we can receive it when we pray. Can I tell you, oh, this is good. Can I tell you where unbelief creeps in? When you ask again. Because the Lord has said, why are you asking? The passage says in Romans, where is that? I have it in my notes here. It says in Romans 8:24, you can write that down. In Romans 8:24, it said, what man hopeth for what he already sees? What man hopeth for what you only hope for what you don't see? Right? So then why are you asking for what you've already received? It's like, do I have any money on me? You know, we live in a generation that doesn't do money. We don't do cash. We do debit cards. I want to just kind of demonstrate this. Ask me for a dollar. Ask me for a dollar. Excuse me? You see how ridiculous that sounds? She has already received from me what she asked. Now, she didn't ask for $2. She asked for $1. And she has already received from me what she asked for. Right? Now, it may not have manifested yet in her bank account. But if she has received it, why is she still asking for it? So the fact that she's still asking for it means apparently I still have. So even if I gave it to her in the spirit, I have to go back and get it. Because now I have to get it all over again. So asking over and over and over again is not the way to get what you need from God. And we think that it is because we have misinterpreted the parable where Jesus talked about the woman who was bugging the king. Over and over and over and over again, she kept going back to the king, and the king finally said, oh my God, get this woman whatever she wants. She's driving me crazy. I don't want God giving me what I asked for on those terms. Oh, Jesus. I want what they call his perfect will. So bugging the Lord is not the way to make things happen. You have to believe that you have received it when ye pray. Now, if you receive, ask for the dollar. And I want you to act like I'm not preaching right now, and it's just real life. We just walking around, talking, having a good time at the mall. Ask for the dollar. Did you hear that? What'd she say? When did she say thank you? She expressed gratitude when she received it. Let's try it again. Okay. It's nothing but a dollar, but go ahead and buy yourself something nice. Preach! So she gave. It didn't mean that she stopped talking to me when she was no longer asking me to give it. She just changed her language. Yeah. Yeah. Ooh, God. So after she has asked and received, even though she hasn't yet received, but she's received because she sees it given to her in the spiritual, with the spiritual eyes, she's received it, then her language changes. And she's no longer asking for what she's already received. Now she's giving thanks. Now she's expressing gratitude. Now she's expressing hope because she realizes that she has what she needs. So what faith is supposed to change our language. Not only does it cause us to start expressing gratitude when we receive it, but it also causes us to change our language even when we're not talking to him. When we're talking to somebody else. How you doing, baby? I'm fine. All my needs are met. All my bills are paid. I am healthy, I am wealthy, and I am wise. But you're walking with a limp. But I received my healing. So therefore, my language is not going to be filtered through the lens of the natural. I have already received in the spirit what I have asked for. Therefore, my language is going to be filtered through the lens of the spirit. Because I don't want my words to tell God I didn't receive what I told you I believe I received. 1 Corinthians. Scratch. Go to Hebrews first. Hebrews chapter 11. Extremely familiar passage, but I want to show you something here. Hebrews 11. Hebrews 11. If you're there, stay there. Hebrews 11. Beginning in verse 1. Now, faith is the assurance, back over to New American, the assurance of things hoped for. It is the evidence or conviction of things not seen. For by it, by faith, the men of old gained approval. By faith, they obtained a testimony or a good report. By faith, the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. By faith, we understand that the worlds were prepared by the word of God. Ooh, watch this. So that what is seen with the physical eye was not made out of things which are visible. Switch over to the King James. Verse 3 here. He says, by faith, we understand that the worlds were framed by the word of God so that the things which are seen were not made of things which do appear. Watch this. So that the things, right? Things. Whatsoever things you desire. Right? The things which are seen were not made of things which do appear. When we talk about a thing, we are talking about something in existence. Something that actually has existent substance. It's not just a concept or an idea, it's a thing. Okay? But watch this. But there's more to things than just things that are seen. There are also things, oh, help me teach this. There are things which do appear. That means that when you are hoping and praying for God to do something and you receive it, you are not just receiving an idea. Ooh, you are not just receiving a concept. You are receiving a thing that does not appear. That means that what you are asking for is as real as it ever will be. It's not just an idea. It's as real as it ever will be the moment you receive it. Even if it does not appear yet. Because there are still things which do not appear. So again, the money that she asked for and received, it did not yet appear, but that didn't mean it didn't exist. So then, what we have a principle here. What eventually appears has to first exist in that which does not appear. Say it again. What eventually appears has to first exist in that which does not appear, because the things which are seen were not made of things which do appear. So then we have two different realms of existence. One is higher than the other. The spirit realm is a higher realm than the natural realm. Okay? And it says here that that which exists in the lower realm can only exist because it existed first. It was made by that which exists in the spirit realm. So where does faith come in? Go back to verse 1. How does faith play a part in this process, this exchange from what exists in the spirit realm so that it comes to exist in the natural realm? First of all, we receive it in the spirit, okay? But then faith is what causes us to receive it in the natural. Look what I said. Now, not later, not when it does appear, but now, faith is, watch it, the substance. If it doesn't exist, it has no substance. But your faith creates it in the spirit. Your faith gives substance to that which you are hoping for. Your faith becomes the evidence, the proof. She said, well, thank you, but for the money. But the money had not materialized yet. But so why are you saying thank you? Because he gave me the money. Well, what evidence do you have? Faith. Faith is the evidence. You can bring faith into the court of heaven as evidence to prove your case. Good God, you have to do what I saw. You said, whatever I see, I receive. You have to do what I saw because I already received it. And my faith is the evidence for it. So there's only one verdict the judge of heaven can come back with. Because faith moves God. Because he doesn't exist in the realm of the seen. He exists in the spiritual realm. That means when you point out the fact that what you have asked for already exists in the spirit, you are showing him, I already see it hiding behind your back. It's already there. And now, God, I pray thee bring the manifestation. But I received it, and my faith is proof that you did what you said you were going to do. Why is it impossible to please the Lord without faith? Right? It is impossible. Is it verse 6? Without faith, it is impossible to please him. Why is it impossible to please the Lord without faith? I'll tell you why. This thing is just vexing me today. I'll tell you why. It is because God is a spirit. Right? And faith operates not in the natural, not in the seen, but in the unseen, in the spirit. So faith is your only way of relating to God. Because he is spirit. So when you don't have faith, you are disconnecting yourself. Oh, man. From who God is. That's deep, saints. That's why we are saved by grace through faith. Because the only way we can be connected to God is through faith. At least in this age of the world. The world says, if God exists, prove it. My faith is evidence. And the world can't understand that because the world is still locked with the other senses. And because it does not compute with their senses, it does not make sense to them. And the thing is, we can understand that when it comes to the world versus the church. But can we understand it when it comes to sick versus healed? When it comes to broke versus prosperous? When it comes to reconciled versus separated? Can we understand the principle that this thing operates in faith? Look in 1 Corinthians chapter 2. And I believe I'll be closing with this verse here. 1 Corinthians chapter 2. I want to bring this thing home. You got to see how faith works. 1 Corinthians 2, when you're there, say there. Excellent. Beginning at verse 9, I'm going to read 9 and 10. I want to skip down to verse 14, but feel free to fill in the blanks at home. Beginning at verse 9, it says that back to the New American Standard, 1 Corinthians 2, verse 9, it says this. But just as it is written, things. There's that word again. Things, honey. Whatsoever things. Faith, the substance of things. Things which did appear were made by things which don't appear. See, you're all, just because it's in the spirit does not stop it from being a thing. And until you realize it's a thing, it really does exist, then faith is not really operating yet. Stop believing for what he's going to do and believe it's done because it's a thing. What's going to happen isn't a thing yet. Amen. Things, he says. All right. Just as written. Things which, watch it, I have not seen, ear has not heard, which have not entered into the heart of man, all that God has prepared for those who love him. For to us, God revealed them. I like the way the King James said, but unto us, God has revealed them. What is them? The things. The things that existed, even though the eyes didn't see it. The things that existed, even though the ears didn't hear it. If my senses weren't able to pick up on it, how did I ever know that it was mine? Because the one who operates in that spiritual realm, the Spirit, pulled back the veil and revealed it to us. Let not your heart be troubled. The thing that you desire and prayed for and received exists and it's already in your hands. Right? Skip down to verse 14. But a natural man does not. Natural, in this instance, means carnal. It means a person who is locked in the physical. Okay? but and who perceives life through the physical. But a natural man does not accept the thing, there we go again. I'm telling you, the word is trying to absolutely convince us that there is more that exists than meets the eye. Okay? The natural man does not accept. What does that word accept mean? Does not receive. He can't receive it in the natural because he didn't receive it in the spirit. And you won't receive. You got to receive it when you believe it. When you pray and when you ask, you have to receive it. But the natural man can't receive it because it can only be received in the spirit where it already exists. You can't receive what doesn't exist. So if the natural man is not tapping into the spirit, there's nothing for him to receive because he's only seeing and hearing with the physical senses. So it says, a natural man does not receive the things of the spirit of God, for they don't make sense. They're not coming in with the five senses. That's why if your faith doesn't make you look foolish to an unbeliever, you don't have the right faith yet. Because it's supposed to be foolishness to him. And he cannot understand them because they are spiritually of the spirit, appraised, discerned, understood, or back to that word, receive. You can't perceive it in the natural until it manifests in the natural. But you can perceive it in the spirit when it manifests in the spirit. And it always manifests in the spirit before it gets to the natural. And if you can just receive it when you perceive it, and you perceive it when you ask, because God is faithful and just, right, to give you whatsoever things you desire, if you pray believing, nothing shall be impossible to them that believe. So say, if you can have the audacity to now, as he said to Abram, to see. As big a salary as you can see, you're only limited by the range of your sight. There's not a cure for this disease, as much healing as you can perceive. Now, if all the healing you can perceive is just getting by without all that pain, that's what you'll have. Until you can see total, complete, absolute healing, you're going to get what you believe God. Whatever you receive is what you shall have. Right? So he says here, let's read it again. A natural man does not accept the things of God, of the Spirit of God, for they are foolishness to him. They cannot understand them because they are spiritually discerned. If we can tap into the Spirit, we can have what we ask God for. Now, clearly understand what I'm saying. Am I saying that this is a get-rich-quick scheme that allows you to get everything you want and to fulfill every desire, every errant desire that you have? As the psalm says, delight yourself in the Lord and he will give you the desires of your heart. Right? If you're not in line with the will and purpose of God, see what the verse said? It said, I have not seen, ear not heard. The senses are not able to pick up the things that God has already prepared, watch this, for them that love him. See, when you're loving him, you're seeking to please him. So it's not all about you and your own lusts and hungers and thirsts and tastes and needs. Why? Because you're not sidetracked by the senses. What threw off Adam and Eve? The senses. What did the Bible say there were three evils in the world? The lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, the pride of life. It's those senses. But even the pride of life can't get in there if the flesh gets under control. So it's the senses. If we can stop being controlled and limited by the scope of our natural vision and wind up like Lot, imprisoned and left with nothing, if we can stop letting what we see deter us, there is no limit to our potential. Because if you can see it, you can receive it. Listen, there is a certain degree of authority that comes with the office of pastor. So let me use that authority right now and tell you this. You have permission to dream again. Everybody receive that. You got to receive it. You got to receive it. You have permission to dream. I know it didn't seem to happen the last time you tried, but you have permission to want it because you got to see it first. If you can't see it, God won't do it. I saw a video. Was it on Facebook a few days ago? I was like, wow, I need to record that and bring it to church and show it to church. The video, but he said a bad word, so I couldn't bring it. But in the video, I said, boy, I could have used this. But in the video, the gentleman talks about realists. And he said, realistic, that's what the word, realistic. He said he was tired of people telling him, be realistic. He said, why? Why should I be realistic? Because realistic limits the scope of what I can get and experience to that which I've already experienced. Because they tell me that experience is the teacher. So if you've never had it, you'll never have it. If mama didn't have it, you won't have it. Right? Because experience has taught. But see, experience is not my teacher. I'm not bound by what has already happened. I'm looking forward to what's going to happen because I've already received it in the spirit as having already happened. So he says, don't have the audacity to tell me to be realistic. I have no interest in operating in this realm. I'm operating in the higher realm where it's not real in your eyes. Because your eyes haven't seen it and your ears haven't heard it. If we can just lock into that, saints, all the limitations would just fall off. All the restriction, all the chains that seem to have held you just out of reach. I feel this my own self. It feels like, you know, there's this great, big, huge, wonderful new level in my life that's right there, just out of reach. And I'm like, God, why can't I get to it? I can taste it in the spirit. I can hear it, but it's just out of reach. And the thing is, saints, you have to see it. You have to hear it. And you have to taste it. That's how it comes to pass. The challenge is, hold on until it comes. Because I can't tell God when to manifest. All I can tell him is, I'm ready because I received it. So I challenge you, saints, whatever it is that you see, things, right? Things. Here's my question. What are your things? Think about that. What things are yours that God has shown you? That you have dreamed about, that you have hoped for, that you have seen, had visions of. What are your things? This church has things. It has a vision statement. We have things that we're believing is going to be made manifest. But we have to receive it in the spirit first. And if you can just have the audacity to receive those things, not after you pray, not in God's time. See, those are we have to get delivered from cliches. Because cliches are not necessarily right. He said, whatsoever things you desire, when ye pray, believe you have received it. In other words, if you're not going to believe that you received it, don't pray. Because you have to believe you received it when you pray. Think about that. How often do we stop before we even ask and make sure that we're ready to receive? Because we don't want our words to be cast to the wind. Pause. And give yourself a moment. Put yourself in the receiving position so that you know that once those words leave your lips, you got it. Don't ask until you're ready to get it. And if you're not ready to receive it yet, then start talking to yourself until you are. Because faith cometh by hearing. So don't keep building faith in not having. I ain't never going to have. I ain't never going to do. We're building faith in the wrong thing by saying it all the time. So start changing our language and getting our whole existence in alignment with that which we are believing God to make manifest.
Thank you.